Hello, everyone. Hello. Welcome to October and the jug that comes with it. Looks like our date change didn't do too badly for the turnout, so that's great. Or maybe Stefan did wonders for the turnout. That's probably what really happened. So we've got some Java news. There's another update. There seems to be one every single month these days. So we've got Java 7 update 45. One of the notable things about this release, they've started going back to, do you remember programming in BASIC on like Commodore 64 and Apple II, where you had to like number the lines, but not consecutively in case you changed your mind and wanted to insert something in between. So that's how they're doing Java update numbering now. So they're doing the major releases are spaced by tens, I think. So update 40 will, the next scheduled update is 50, and then the next scheduled update is 60, I guess. And then if they need to insert one before the next scheduled update comes out, it's called a critical patch update, very confusingly called a Java CPU. that's what they're actually called. And they include generally security fixes that couldn't wait. So this one, update 45, follows update 40. There's no in between. And it's mostly applet and web start security updates. A lot of them look like they're actually preventative maintenance. A lot more warnings about things. They've added same origin policies in a lot of different places where there weren't before. So now if your jar file is served from a different host than the HTML file that referenced it, there's a warning. None of this actually prevents people from using your Java applets or your web start program, but it adds another prompt, probably like a fourth prompt at this point, I think, that says you really, really, really don't want to do this, and you have to press OK. But you still can press OK and run the applet at this point. I'm guessing in a future version, all of these advisory warnings will turn into there's no OK button anymore.
You can put in the manifest that it has to be sandboxed, though.
Like yes.
You can seal security level into the manifest now. You can do this.
Right, yes, that was something else. I think that came out in the previous update to this
40.
One. Yeah, so you can prevent a website from embedding your jar file in a way that says it gets more permissions than it should. Okay, you can also now reset all the security prompts so you can untrust everything you've trusted in the past. And Live Connect, which is the Java to JavaScript bridge, it's bidirectional, now enforces the same origin policy. Which, of course, they don't call it same origin. I think they call it same code base or something, just for fun. OK, so there's this Java Zero Day website, which has been keeping an eye on the zero day status of Java. It's almost at triple digits now. This is the first time ever since the website launched that we're going to maybe hit 100 days. I just got it just now. Why? Do you think it's too high?
Yeah.
They've included 7U45 as the latest patch for this data, so it should be correct. Yeah, it was for quite a while there. Every meeting it was less than 30, meaning that there had been a zero day.
Seems a bit high.
What would have been the most recent vulnerable release then?
Is there a Java?
Oh, yes, you can.
Is there javazeroday.com? Which I think it still returns yes. I think it's still.
Oh boy. Yeah, you can look into that more. Okay, so DevOps is sold out and it's coming up soon. Is anybody going? Christian's going. Yes. So that's a conference that I think most people who go there really enjoy it. It's a good value too compared to the entry price for a lot of other conferences. And JFolk is coming up in Stockholm, also a good value. But travel's a lot more expensive to Stockholm than it is to Antwerp. So Java 1, a few of us were there, including me this year. They had a few themes that I kind of noticed. One of them, Java 8 for realsies this time. Last year the theme was also Java 8's coming anytime now. So it was kind of a bit of a repeat there. They're trying to build a ton of developer interest in doing embedded programming. There was a whole track about Java on embedded devices, including but not limited to Raspberry Pi. They mentioned it in the technical keynote. They mentioned it in the closing keynote. There was a lot of focus on Java for embedded. I think they're seeing it as the new smartphone space that Java can get into and kind of take over, because there's not a clear winner there right now. And enterprise Java was also a big theme, with EE7 having come out pretty soon before Java 1. And finally, probably the newest news item, this was just a few days ago, Brian Goetz put out a survey on SurveyMonkey. I'll post a link to the Google Plus group and the mailing list. It's a multiple choice. Which of the following best expresses your feelings about erase generics? Erasure is great. Erasure sucks. Erasure was and continues to be a practical compromise, and a very wordy one that boils down to, it's too late now. Like, we made that choice. Adding reified generics at this point would just make everybody upset. And then they would very much like you to answer the next question, which is why, and they give you a big text area to write in. So I'll post a link, and I think everyone should think about this and respond to the survey, because they're going to get started on whatever kind of reification is going to come in Java 9. They're going to start working on it right away. Finally, every time I go to San Francisco, I mean to visit the Computer History Museum, and I actually did for the first time, and it was well worth the trip to Mountain View. So if you're ever in San Francisco, give yourself a day to get down there and go to that. It's really good. Anything else?
Aaron Gupta.
Oh, yeah. Arun, yeah. So he was the Java evangelist at Oracle for a long time. Very active in the whole Java community space. He's just switched sides, and he's working for Red Hat as of Monday this week.
Yeah, he was one of their big bloggers behind Glassfish and the EE standard. And
yep.
If you heard about those things, it was probably for him.
I saw in his Twitter feed he's just trying to build interest around NetBeans Jira he submitted, which was requesting Wildfly AS support in NetBeans. So trying to connect his two worlds. Okay, so without further ado, we'll hear from Stefan.
All right. Okay, welcome to my talk, Web Security 101. My name is Stefan. I work at Mozilla in the security assurance team. And what I do there is I mostly deal with web application security of both our own applications and third-party applications. This is more of an introduction session, but I think there are still a bunch of cool things that you can pick up. Oh, sorry. I think web security in general is in a pretty poor state. If you look at, we recently scanned like the Alexa top million websites, and it turned out that like a lot of those websites, like the high 80 to 90%, don't implement even the most basic things that you can do. So I'm going to talk about those things, specifically related to frames, SSL, cookies, CSRF, and cross-site scripting. So what I really hope is that even though these things are basic, I hope you can pick up one or two things of what I'm going to explain and maybe actually implement those or improve a website that you work on or that you host. So I want to start really simple. I want to start with frames. There are all kinds of interesting attacks possible on frames, using frames, phishing, framing, click checking. Here's a really simple example. I did this talk for at a conference called OHM 2013, and this is the conference website. But there's something strange going on here. You've probably not seen the original website, but that Facebook banner was not on the original website. So what happened here? If you look at the URL, you can see that the zero in 2013 it's a little bigger than usual because someone registered the domain that looks very similar, except they replaced the O or the zero with an O. And what they did is they put a frame set on that website, and the bottom frame is the original content, which works as expected. And then the top part of that page is a frame set that contains a fake Facebook login page. So this is a really stupid example. Well, it's not that stupid. People actually do this. But people also actually log into pages like this. So it's really easy to spam people with links to a site like this and say, hey, look, this looks like the real site. Please log in. And in the meantime, your credentials are stolen. So
can you speak up a little bit?
Speak up?
Yeah.
Okay. This is another example. So this is a similar concept. This looks like a page where you are being asked to re-enter your password. But what actually happened here is that the original page is this one. So again, the original website has been put in a frame set. And then on the attacker website, people simply put content on top of that frame set. So as you can see, the only original thing here is the password field. It now says password, but in the original page it says confirm password. And we just modify the page by putting divs, solid divs, on top of the original page so that people don't see what's actually going on. I recently reviewed a bug that was reported on one of our own websites where someone put a similar overlay on the website. And it basically said, to claim your prize, click here, click there, fill in your username here. And what actually happened was that by clicking there and there, you actually submitted your credentials or your password to an attacking website. So it's really easy to prevent these kind of attacks. The only thing you have to do is you set a header on your web server, which is called the X-Frame Options header. If you set this header to deny, then the browser will never put your website in a frame set. Unless you want to, then you can say same origin, and then you tell the browser you can only embed this site on the same site. So if your website is composed of frames, if you actually use frames, then it is allowed. But if you set X-frame options to deny, then no other website can actually embed you. And this is really simple. This is a one-line change in Apache or Nginx. All browsers. Yeah.
Version from like more recent one or?
This is really, really old. This is like this is like years and years old.
So this is the meta stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. So this is a header, an HTTP header that your web server should send. So ideally, you just configure this in Apache or Nginx or your servlet hosting container. And you say, for this application, always send this header. And that's it. You've now protected yourself against these kind of attacks. 99% of the websites don't do this. And they really don't need frames. But yet, they are vulnerable to these kind of attacks.
Could an attacker then use a filter and proxy to?
Well, it gets really difficult, because then the attacker has to sit between the website and the person looking at the site, and that's people are not that advanced. No, would be a very focused attack on a specific person, for example. It happens, but another thing that happens is that people put your website in a website that just has banners all around it, advertisements. So if you have valuable content on your site, and I want to make money, I just put your site in a frame set and I put advertisements all around it. And people click on it or look at it and I get money back from the advertisements.
The frame set location bar would still say it's a different website, right?
Yeah, but people are easily fooled. Like, did you see the difference in this on this side?
I always use a location bar.
Yeah. Yeah, or just make a variation. Instead of OM 2013, you can say OM 2013 conference, and people will still believe it's the legit website. You can even register an SSL certificate for this, because there's no checks on that. Okay. So my next favorite topic is SSL, HTTPS. It's been a lot in the news recently because of all the revelations of Edward Snowden and what the NSA is capable of. This is a really tough subject. But the first thing I would like to recommend to you, if you host a website that is protected with SSL, run one of the online tests. Qualys has a really good one. It not only gives you a rating, like here, It goes to your website and it looks at the configuration, it downloads a page, it looks at the SSL configuration. It gives you a rating, but what you don't see on this page is that there's like a really long report under that that explains in detail what you can improve to do this better. For example, this is the website of the Dutch police agent, Dutch police, where you can actually file a report online, and they get a solid F because they're using, I think SSL 2.0, which is like really, really bad. So this gives you a really good indication of your server configuration.
Is this free or get the
paperwork? No, it's free. Okay. Yeah. They use this data to do, they're a security company. They use this data obviously to do all kinds of statistics and research. But it's public data anyway. Anyone can connect to your website and retrieve this, right? They do have a hall of shame. So if you do really bad, you will show up in the hall of shame. But they have a commercial service, but this is fine. So the other thing you should really do if you use SSL is set this header, the strict transport security header. And what this means, this is really cool. As soon as someone visits your website over SSL, and the browser gets this header back from the web server, then the browser will remember, oh, this site is secured. I should never ever visit the plain text website anymore. So as soon as you have sent this back once, you can set an expiration time on it. I don't know what this number means. It's probably a couple of weeks in seconds. It means that even if the user types HTTP mozilla.com, the browser will say, oh, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to HTTPS mozilla.com. And this is really powerful because links are everywhere and it just prevents data leakage. If you happen to have a cookie that's maybe not properly configured and can leak out over an unsecured connection, this will prevent that from happening. This works in every browser now. Maybe not in IE6, but pretty much in every browser. So this works from links to other from other website to your website, links on your own website, anything that a user types into the browser. It's really cool. And same with the X-frame option stuff. This is a one-line configuration in your web server. So there's really no excuse to not do this. All right. Number three, cookies. Any questions so far?
Will this be available as a download?
Sure. Yeah. I'll put a link on the projector.
Yeah, we can post it to the joke site as well.
Okay, cool. So a quick refresher. Cookies are a way to maintain state. What happens is that the web server will send a set cookie header back to the client, to the web browser that contains a cookie name and a value, and where that cookie should be sent to, a domain and a path, and when it expires, and some flags. And then once the web browser has received that cookie, it will store it. If there's no expiry date, then the cookie will only be valid for that one session, and it will not be stored anywhere. And then on every request that follows, the browser will send it back to the server. So this is how you do your session management. It's a really old mechanism, and it's the way we do state on the web. So there's lots of things that can go wrong here. You can store bad data in the cookie. You can do bad things with the domain name or the path. And there are flags. So let me talk a bit about those. So ideally, the only thing you store in a cookie is a really, really good random number that points to something that you store on your server. Usually a cookie looks like this, like a card ID. Okay, this is not a really random number, but it should be like a hash value or something based on the current time or in the IP address or something that your framework generates that's good random. Most frameworks do this for you. What you should absolutely not do is put predictable data in the cookie, because the cookie is stored in the web browser. So if I sit behind my web browser and you send me something like a user ID or a card ID, that in this case is like an easily guessable number, I can just go into my cookie browser in my browser's developer tools, and I can change those numbers. And this actually happens. A while ago, we reviewed a website, and the role of the current user was stored in the cookie. So normally, when you log into that web application, it would say, okay, your role is a guest. I changed it to administrator, and I became an administrator. But these are things that happen for real. So never ever do this. Ideally, you only store a reference in the cookie that points back to something that you store on the server side. Like you store it in a cache or in a database. So you correlate that session ID to an object or a session thing or a dictionary that you have on the server side. It's also good to not store like any personal identifiable information. Like many websites store a username or an email address in the cookie, but it's better not to do it. It's better to just keep that all private on the server and not send it over the wire. There's always a chance that you leak it or that it gets exposed. It's just better to not do it. The last point, serialized objects. This is an attack. It happened a couple times in the Python world, in the Ruby world. It's really nasty. They take a native object and they serialize it and then store it in a session. But now what happens is that in the web browser you have this, say this archived Java object or Python object. You can actually mess with that. You can put code in it. You can change the, you can make it point to classes that you really shouldn't know about. And then what happens if the server takes that object back and deserializes it? It will actually execute everything that's in there. It will, ideally, it only contains data, but in these specific cases, people are actually able to put Python code or Ruby code in that cookie and have the server execute it. So that's pretty bad. Another thing to know is that a cookie travels to all locations that match to the domain name and the path. So you really want to avoid wildcard domains. I'll explain why. And you also actually want to avoid a top-level path that is maybe too wide. It's better to be more specific. Because, for example, if you have, say you have a website, bigisp.net / self-service, which is an area on that site where you need to log in, and say after you log in, you get a cookie back, and that cookie is set to .bigisp.net, and the path is set to /, then that same cookie will go to every site that's hosted there. So even if there is like user-hosted content for that ISP on, say, homepages.bigisp.net, that cookie will go there. If there is a blog or data on a CDN that's aliased to that same domain, the cookie will go there. So now suddenly the cookie that's actually only relevant for that small piece of your website, that small part, will go to a much wider audience. And that opens up all kinds of interesting attacks. So you really want to be very specific. And I think if you can, it's pretty good practice to put applications on a specific subdomain or on a specific part of the path and limit the cookie to that. There's two other things I want to quickly talk about. You can set two flags for cookies, secure and HTTP only. Secure is really simple. If you set that flag, it will never travel to an unsecured website. So good practice is you log into a site and it's all SSL. If you don't set that flag, the cookie will also travel to non-secured pages, which means that anyone who's sitting in the middle who can listen to your connection, maybe at Starbucks or somewhere else, can see that cookie. I think 1 or 2 years ago we had a Firefox add-on. I think it was called Firesheep, and it basically embedded a packet sniffer in a Firefox extension, and you enabled it. It was all very very smooth and simple. You clicked a button and it would start listening to HTTP requests, and show you a list of all the websites that people on the same network were visiting. And with one click, you could log into that website. Because people don't set this, set these flags or don't use SSL, that means if cookies are sent over the clear, then I can take that cookie and I can become your, I can become you and log in. I can take over your session. And the other flag is HTTP only. This is also really important because usually cookies are available through JavaScript, accessible through JavaScript, through document.cookie. You get access to exactly the same data that the browser has stored for that browsing session. If you set this flag, document.cookie will always be empty. So if there's somehow an attack where someone can execute code on your website in the browser as that user, then the code can never actually hijack your session. And in 99% of the cases, you don't even need access to the cookies that are being sent from JavaScript. So this is a, it's a really good practice. The browser will block access, but it will still know the cookie. So if you make XML HTTP requests or regular requests, it will still be sent, but it will not be visible to code. So this is what it looks like on the wire. This is what the server sends to the client. How you set these flags depends on the specific web framework that you use. There is usually a flag or a method somewhere in your session object that says set secure, set HTTP only. I'm not super familiar with what's being used in Java these days, but I'm pretty sure that's possible. Yeah, it's often the default now, yeah. You can check your cookies really simple. You can just use your, if you have a browser, modern browser, there's great developer tools included, especially in Firefox. With Chrome and Safari too, you can browse the cookies, you can see exactly what the browser received from the server. So it's really simple to test if you've set the right things. All right. So this is one of the most common attacks that we see, most common vulnerabilities that we see on websites. It's called cross-site request forgery. What does this mean? It's based on the fact that when you log in to a website, your browser remembers that cookie. And no matter how you visit that website, even if you click a link to that site in an email, or you click a link on another website, in another website that points to you, the browser will make a request, and if the browser has cookies for that site, it will send them. There's no choice, there's no opt-out. When you are signed in and you visit a website, the cookies are being sent. It's actually impossible to make an unauthenticated sessionless request to a website unless you manually start like a private browsing session. But once you're logged into Facebook, especially Facebook, you're pretty much logged in for life. And if I send you a link to a picture or whatever, your browser will be logged in and you will immediately go to that page. So, and this is the normal, this is how things work. But the problem with that is that if I send you a link to something that's that has side effects, like in this case, imaginary foomail.com delete all email.php. This happens for real. And you click on that link, which I named claim your prize here, your email will be deleted. The same with a bank transfer. Now, banks are not that silly, but there are a lot of variations of this attack, which actually happen for real every day. And it's not just for GET requests, it's also for POST requests. GET requests are really simple. POST requires a little more effort because they're embedded in a form, but it's not that hard to do. So for example, here's a, for some imaginary bank, here's a form that posts for a transfer form. So I'm going to make a bank transfer. The form has two fields, to an amount. When I click the button, this will be posted back to the server, to the bank server. Now, what an attacker can do is just create a web page. And instead of setting the action to a relative action in the original bank site, we just specify the full URL. And we make all the form elements hidden. And we just put a button in there that says claim your prize. And when I click that, that form will actually be posted back to the bank. If there's no protection, then this will actually work if you're still logged into the bank. Now, banks are usually a bit stricter with this, and they do have good protection against this. But there are many websites where this totally works. And it doesn't have to be as serious as doing a money transfer, right? It can also be faking a form to change your password and your email address, or something like that. And now I, as the attacker, have access to your account. So how do you prevent against this attack? It's really simple. The key here is that an attacker does a blind attack. The attacker doesn't really know anything. He only knows that if I post to this forum, things will happen. So, but the attacker cannot actually doesn't actually sit behind your computer and cannot actually fill in things. So it's really a blind attack. So what you do is you can add a hidden form field that contains like a unique number that only you know, or that only your server knows. And then when your form is submitted, you check against that session or that token. How does that work? So basically in your session, sorry, this is pseudo Python code, but in your session you store some random token. And then in your form you include a hidden field which you call CSRF token or session token or whatever. And now, when this form is submitted, the first thing you do is you check, does this field actually match what I've generated for this user? And the attacker can never know that, because it's something that is generated when you request the form. And then when you submit it back, only the browser that actually requested that web page will know this. So the attacker can no longer blindly post to forms. Most popular frameworks have some infrastructure for this, but many don't. So if you use some framework that generates forms for you, you really want to view source and look at the actual fields generated and see what's in there. And if there's no CSRF token, depending on what the form does, you probably want to do that. You can do the same for GET requests, but it's generally better to not use GET requests for operations that modify data. It's better to do POSTs or any of the other HTTP commands, which means you probably have to do a little JavaScript, but it does make things safer, because if you change, in this case, if you change this GET request for some operation to a POST request, there's no way that an attacker can mess with that. And another thing is, these GET requests will also appear in the web server log. You might not want to do that. We had a website where the login page actually used a GET request. So your username and password would appear as parameters in the GET request. So the Apache logs of that server actually contained the whole username and password database in plain text. Am I going too fast? No? Okay. Sorry, I know it's a lot. Okay, and this is really, cross-site scripting is really our number one problem on the web, I think. And this leads to all kinds of nasty things. Phishing, malicious code execution is probably the number one reason for malware distribution. It's bad. So what is XSS? XSS is when I trick you into executing JavaScript in your browser. So it's a client-side attack. Which means that if I can execute code in your web browser, I can look at the page that you look at. I can look at your cookies, if you didn't set that flag. I can make requests as you on that same website. I'll show some examples. So here's a really simple example of what we call a reflected XSS attack. So in this case, we have a really simple web handler called hello. And if you call this with the N parameter, and you set it to my name, it will just print my name between in an H1 block, which is good. The problem here is that if I put HTML in that parameter, that will just be reflected back into the page. So if I put some script code in there, the actual generated HTML will now look like this. So if I put this link in an email and I send that to like a couple million people, which happens for real, this is how they distribute XSS attacks, and people start clicking on that, and the link is actually to Facebook, then I'm actually executing JavaScript in the context of the Facebook web application. And that means I can do all kinds of stuff, because now I am executing code as if I am logged into Facebook. And we've seen really complex rootkits, actually, that completely take over your website. Like the initial JavaScript payload is small, and then it actually injects much bigger scripts into a page to, for example, put your whole website into an iframe. And then every link on your site and every form is basically wrapped in some attack code that will just work exactly the same way it did before, except now it will record everything and push everything back to an attacking server, etc. The biggest offender here is PHP, because every PHP example or book starts like this. Just echo your name back. And it just takes what you put in the name parameter and puts it back in the page. You can see that on GitHub. If you do a creative query for that, you get like 500,000 hits back. I like to make fun of PHP, but this happens pretty much in every framework, in every language. A persistent attack is very similar, except now you manage to store something in the database. So for example, if you have a method to update your profile, and you don't really check what people fill in the name field, now you can suddenly transfer a little bit of JavaScript into the name field that will be stored in the database. And the next time you look at that page that actually retrieves your name from the database, it will take that JavaScript code and put it back in the page. So these attacks are the best, because you can prepare your attack and it just sits on the server, and you can send out a link that doesn't look dangerous at all. And there are many possibilities to inject stuff into pages. So the most basic thing is if you can inject straight into content text, you can basically take any chunk of HTML and put it back in the page. That's the top example. But for example, if you can inject in a place where, a tag attribute, the style attribute in this case, it's really not that hard, because the only thing you have to inject here is you make sure you close the attribute correctly, and then you close the tag correctly, and then you're back at like the level where you can actually inject script and so forth. And the same with parameters in JavaScript functions. There's hundreds and hundreds of factors that you can use. I'm not saying that these are all things that can potentially happen, but you have to be very careful when you generate, when you have dynamically generated content. So these attacks are so serious that the companies listed here, they have bug bounty programs. They pay you money when you find a bug on one of their web properties. As you can see, Mozilla and Google, we pay good money for XSS bugs that people find on our websites, because these are really nasty. We probably pay $3,000 or more if you find an XSS bug on more important sites where people have to log in, or that people maintain personal data. On a wiki, the amount is probably a little lower, but if you can really expose personal data, then we take that very seriously. And Google goes way up, actually. So there's all kinds of cool stuff you can do. Once you can inject scripts into an existing page, you can load more scripts, you can mess with the DOM, you can change the layout of the page, you can hijack the session, you can redirect to malware, very popular. You just change the location of the current page to some random other page where people will be offered malware in the form of Java applets or ActiveX components. Happens a lot. So there's really three things you can do to prevent this. I'm going to skip the part in the middle, but the biggest issues are people do not correctly validate what they take, and they don't correctly escape what they output. Although this looks like a problem that's mostly focused on around outputting the right correctly escaped data, it really starts with what you take from a user. So if you have a form where people can type random text, for example, a name field or a city name or whatever, you really want to be sure that that data is properly sanitized before you put it in your database, or ideally rejected when the form is submitted. So you can do all kinds of things. You can do regular expressions, and frameworks have all kinds of good validation methods. Be sure to do it on the server side and not just on the client side, because with a little bit of JavaScript you can just go around that usually. Especially in the case of a persistent attack, it's okay if it's hard to exploit. As long as you get that data in the database, it's okay. There's lots of unit tests that you can write with funny input and see if that works. And even if you have like a pop-up menu that has fixed values like Canadian province names, don't expect people to not mess with that. Be sure that you check that it's actually two letters instead of a piece of JavaScript. And there are really great open source tools to test against this. Our favorite is Zap. It's called the Z Attack Proxy. One of my colleagues maintains it, and it's basically it's a proxy server, but it has a nice GUI. You can follow what you are browsing, and then at one point when you see a page with a form that you visited, you can go to Zap, and you can say attack this page, and it will run all kinds of tests against that form. It will try to inject JavaScript, do SQL injection attacks, all kinds of nasty stuff. And it's really good at it. So the other part of preventing XSS is escaping the things you output in web pages, but also in CSS. Anything that you dynamically generate. I would say even emails. We've seen attacks where people put, where you have an input field where you put your email address. And then people manage to put a bunch of carriage returns in there and just add more headers under your email address. So what happens is in the template for the email, you have two and then the email address, and that's good. But then when people start putting new lines in there, they can just start adding other headers like CC and BCC and another subject. And yeah, it works great. There's all kinds of crazy attacks that you can do. So what you really want to do is you want to, when you dynamically generate something, you want to escape for the specific context that you are in. If you are outputting something on an HTML page, you might want to make sure that the brackets are properly escaped so people cannot generate HTML. While if you generate data in an attack attribute, you probably want to do a different kind of escaping. But most template systems do this for you. So please don't reinvent the wheel, and please use something that's proven and well maintained, because that will probably catch 99% of these issues. I think pretty much every templating system now does the write escaping by default. What we often see is that people, they need to do like a little, oh yeah, you're unsubscribed from our mailing list, thank you, page. And then like, ah, template is too much work, I just print that to in my servlet or in my Ruby on Rails handler, I just print that. And then, yeah, they actually introduce an XSS because they just print the data straight away without escaping it. And escaping is really hard because, for example, say, I don't think this example works anymore, but this used to work in older browsers. If you set the source of an image to some JavaScript, it will actually execute that JavaScript. So say you think you're smart and you're going to say, okay, everything with, I'm going to reject everything with the single quote. Well, then I'm just going to do this, right? And you say, okay, I'm gonna escape a little more. Well, fine, I'll just escape it like this. This is exactly the same. And okay, you can probably catch this too, but then there's this. And you can catch this too, but then there's this. It's all the same. It's really, really horrible, but HTML is so flexible. There's like a million possibilities. HTML5sec.org has like, I think, 200 examples of execution points and ways of escaping and breaking out of escape values. It's really cool to see. So, for example, in the last one, we often see websites where they print a little debug data in a comment. So who knew that with a single backtick, you can actually break out of that comment? So if you manage to put a backtick in there, you end that comment, and now you can just add a bunch of code. And there's all kinds of stuff. We very frequently see code where you take a URL for like a profile image or something, and that URL is put back into a page, and then people check, let's just see if this is JavaScript with a string comparison. But it turns out that in the first example here, this is actually valid, and this actually, the ABC is ignored by the browser, but probably not by your code, but it still turns into JavaScript, right? It's really nasty. There's all kinds of crazy exceptions. This list can go on and on. Okay, I'm running out of time, so I'm going to skip this part.
No rush.
Okay, so there's also a thing called the web application firewall. This is something that sits in between or in front of your web server. This thing is really a smart proxy server that knows about specific attacks. So when it sees someone trying to do an XSS attack, it will say, oh, this looks like an attack, I'm going to deny that request. In my opinion, it's not used enough. We especially like it when you host something commercial, closed source, something third party that you don't really know about. You put it behind a web application firewall and you immediately block a whole range of attacks that you would otherwise go unnoticed. You can also run it in passive mode. If you don't trust this, you can just look at the log files and see what it actually blocks and if it blocks anything. You'll be surprised. I think we ran this in front of some popular forum software, and we saw all kinds of crazy attacks going through. There are a couple of really great open source solutions actually. Mod Security is for Apache servers, and there's Nuxi for Nginx. Apache and Internet Information Server.
What are the major vendors for the web firewalls?
I don't know. I have a friend who works at A10. He told me to put his name on the slide. I didn't, but I think A10 makes a commercial web application firewall. Yeah, so these two, Mod Security and Nuxi, are open source, and they're actually really good. You can find all kinds of rule sets for these two to recognize the most common attacks. And XSS is usually really easy to recognize, actually. And if you're in doubt, because they could block things that they're not supposed to block, you can run them in passive mode, so you can just look what they would do. This is the last part of my presentation. So there's really one cool thing happening right now, which is called CSP, Content Security Policy. This is something that's being developed by W3C, which is, I think, mostly implemented in Firefox and Chrome at the moment. And what this does is you can set very strict policies on web pages that the browser has to follow. So what does that mean? CSP is another header. So your server sends this header to the browser, which means it's really difficult to mess with it. And what do these rules mean? Well, for example, you can say from what locations is this web page allowed to load content. So you can specify in detail where the images on your site, or the audio or video elements, or even the applets and fonts, all the embedded content, where it's allowed to come from. So for example, this is the default CSP header. By default there's no CSP policy. Yep.
Is it HTML5 compatible?
Sorry?
Is it HTML5 compatible?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So this is a really good but strict start. If you say my content security policy is only allow self as the source of my content, that you're basically saying only content, the browser is only allowed to load content that comes from the same site. So if I load something from mozilla.com, then only the images and the fonts and everything has to come from mozilla.com. So even if an attacker manages to sneak a link to a Java applet on that page, it cannot load because it probably comes from a different server or a Flash banner or whatever. You can also say you're not allowed to load that at all. So if your website doesn't use frames, you can say I'm going to have a default policy to only load content from my own site, from the same site, but the source for frames and embedded objects is none, which means they're not allowed to load at all. And because this is set by the server as a header, it's really, really difficult to mess with that. You really have to be on the wire to mess with that. Here's another example. Nobody, probably not a single site, hosts content completely on the same server. So for example, if you load jQuery from the Google CDN, you can just say, okay, scripts are allowed to load from my own domain and from Google, from this specific domain. But this is really cool because you can do all kinds of tricks that you can do. You can do a policy that really defines how your site is built up, and you cannot break out of that. So even if someone manages to put to run XSS on your server, you can never link back to another site. This says embedded objects, which is for Flash, are only allowed from YouTube. For example, if you have a blog that embeds YouTube movies. So I'm going to make that exception. I'm going to allow Flash, but only to YouTube.com.
So this is all HTTP head on the records, right?
Yep.
And how well they are supported right now?
Very well in Firefox and Chrome. A little less well in Safari. I think Safari uses an older specification. But this is going to be so big, I think a year from now, all major browsers will support this.
It's all kind of standard driven, there's no kind of variation in the browser.
Yeah, there always is, but it's standard driven, yeah. So the second thing you can control is where XML HTTP requests are allowed to go to. So say an attacker injects some scripts on your page that collect some data and then use a XML HTTP request to push it back to a remote site. That's not possible anymore because you can say, only allow XML HTTP requests to my server and my API server, for example. Same for forms in the future version. That will happen pretty soon. Now, and the most beautiful thing of CSP, you can also say inline scripts are not allowed anymore, and inline styles are not allowed anymore. So this immediately kills the whole XSS problem, because XSS requires that you have embedded scripts. It requires that you're able to inject those scripts in a page. But with this simple rule, do I have the rule actually? I don't have the rule. Okay. Anyway, the rule is like I can show it later. But it's like a keyword in the policy that says no embedded content allowed.
Are there ways to like do this without the server specifying it? Like, could you force your browser to do these sort of things?
Yeah, there's a great add-on for Firefox called User CSP, and it's really to test your CSP rules. But it will apply the rules in the browser. So it's more for testing and development, but you can play with it. You can create a rule without actually having to change anything on your server, and then you can see if your website renders correctly. Both Chrome and Firefox will actually output in the developer console if there are violations. So it will print, hey, we could not load this image because it served from a domain that's blocked. Yeah. User CSP. So these are the things it blocks. Event handlers, embedded scripts in Ahrefs, and just plain scripts inline. And the same for styles. Why style? Because you can also do very interesting things with CSS. You can actually put JavaScript in CSS. You can change the layout of the page, etc. So it's, in general, it's not a good idea to use inline styles and inline scripts. So there's one consequence of that. You cannot do this anymore. You cannot actually embed scripts in your page and do something like this. But that's okay, because this is a better coding practice anyway. Now you've separated the JavaScript from the content, and in your content, in foo.html, here you simply give that button an ID. And in your script file, you simply bind a specific handler to that button action. Instead of here, you do it all inline. So that is a big change. So it can be difficult to apply this to existing websites, especially if they are like dynamically generated by something ugly like WordPress or a CMS. But if you start something new, I would strongly advise to make this kind of separation.
I just had a question. Was there going to be a way to annotate elements in the page so that part of the DOM was kind of locked down?
Sort
of seems to go on with this.
I don't know.
Sort of help with that particular use case, right? Say this part of the page is static content that I don't want to get, and I can still have scripts.
Yeah, I think we're doing that specifically for the, like a good example is Google Analytics, where you do have to embed it. You have to embed a little piece of JavaScript. I think the plan is to we're going to allow you to add tags, a tag to a specific piece of content, and then in the CSP you can say this is allowed.
The rules for that.
Yeah. Yeah. Angular is really well supported. Well, it's the other way around. Angular really well supports CSP. I did an Angular app a while ago, and the only thing I had to change was from ng app, I changed it to ng CSP app in the main tag. And then Angular does the right things, and But it depends on the framework, right? If your framework, for example, dynamically compiles templates using eval, then it might not work so well. Because
all the HTML5 frameworks and stuff, they are real weird. They kind of piece of these things.
if it's a modern framework, it's probably ready for this. Yeah. Last thing, you can also turn on reporting. That means every time there's a violation, a little JSON report of that violation will be sent back to your server. So this is really cool. You can also run the you can also run it in report only mode. So even if there's a violation, the browser will not do anything, but it will send back a notification to your website. I recommend to not enable this on a high traffic production site, because that can possibly generate a lot of reports. But it's a good way if you do this selectively, like for a few percentage of your users, you can see if your policy is correct and if it generates any false positives or not. This is my pitch. It has great potential. No, really. I think this is pretty much the deal breaker for XSS and many other attacks in the browser. It's fairly very early days, but I think after a few years, this will be the number one reason why we're not going to see a bunch of popular attacks anymore. So these are all the things I talk about. Yay! I'll leave this slide on, so you can look at some things. But we'll put a link up to the slides on the website. Questions? No questions? Hello.
I know you didn't cover it, but I was wondering what's your take on single page applications? Kind of related, but
yep.
With the single page, I'm talking about it like a pure single page application where you get the initial application, then you request JSON objects and so on. Would you say because the scope of a server is much smaller, then it's perhaps a bit more secure? Of course, there's still problems, but what do you see in the field, I guess?
It's a model that we also moved to, and what I really like is that for those applications, you basically only have a small API on the server, so the attack surface on the server side is much smaller and much more contained. I think it's a really good practice. You can really narrow down what actually happens on the server and test that really well. But everything I talked about still applies. You can still make the same. You can still make the same mistakes even in single page applications.
Right, but yeah. Just because the server scope is much smaller, most of the code is really on the client.
Yeah. Right, so. Yeah, correct.
Made my job a lot easier.
Mine too. Yeah.
So are you suggesting that the whole entire site should be SSL enabled, or do you just have just the regular site without any? HTTPS, is that fine or
not? It depends what you do. If you're a newspaper and you're just displaying articles, then it's totally fine to not use SSL. It's hard to say. If there is personal information involved, or if you are in an environment where you don't want three-letter organizations to see what your users are looking at, it's better to encrypt things.
I don't think there are many reasons left why you shouldn't use SSL.
SSL no, is so cheap.
It's cheap, yeah.
You can get free certificates, you can just turn it on, it takes almost no CPU.
Yeah.
It's like, you might as well.
Yeah.
Don't think you're going to be using a lot of CPU on your server for SSL.
That was that FireSheep thing where it was like, just look at people's faces and click on them to log into their Facebook, and was enabled because Facebook was only using SSL for their login page, and then they were reverting to unencrypted communications.
Yeah.
So Yahoo still does that. Yahoo still only does SSL.
There's no good reason.
Yeah. Maybe. So anytime you're in a public network, people can see your session.
Yeah. But yeah, it's cheap. I bought a wildcard certificate last week for $40. SSL doesn't, I don't really value that green button because it's still very difficult to really verify that you're looking at original content of the right party. But you do make it more difficult for someone in the middle who wants to intercept that. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.